Chickens and bunnies. I said it was so cool, but he still makes me yummy plant foods. He makes me those things. What are those
peeps?
Peeps.
We want to make sure that we provide, we continue to provide. So we will have something for them and something for adults as well. So Rick and Kimmy, tell them we will have something for them, and but we will have the word for them. Amen. There will be a word. We want the altar packed. We want people that need Jesus, people that need deliverance. Amen. I said amen. Amen. And so we have some things, wonderful things going on. Also, after service, I need to see Jasmine. I need to see you and a few other people. I'll see them. But amen. It's going to be a wonderful, 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 wonderful time. We will get our giving after. Let's go on with our giving. Now, if you need an okay. Well, we're going to have our Pastor Doctor. PDT. Is that like a spring? We're going to have him come on. PDT will come on. And so, good afternoon, everybody. Clap your hands for him.
Before we go and do offering and do anything else, I just want to
and celebrate some more Palm Sunday. Amen. Palm Sunday is the entry day. Think about the triumphant entry. And think about as he entered, bless you, as he entered into Jerusalem, he's entering to a new gate, a gateway, a door, a new season. This starts over. We're walking through a gateway right now. Somebody say that word, gateway. So it's important that we take advantage of the fast. It's important that we take advantage of every spiritual thing we can at this time. Everybody had time to that they may have seen a fight or gotten a fight. I remember when I first learned to fight in Washington, D.C. I called my cousin, they were my cousins, James, James and Dale, and Jamil up the street, Maurice was over the brother. We didn't have Maurice was, but they always fight for me a lot of times. Somebody messed with me, messed with Donnie up, they were there with us for a lot of times. Then one day, James said, you fight, and if you lose, I'm gonna beat you up. I love you, that one. I said, I ain't losing today, I love you. But I got in a fight, and I'll never forget, I hit him, right? And all of a sudden I hit him, and boy, I connected with that nose. His nose bleeding, started bleeding, and he did like this. And what I did was, I just jumped, pounced. I ain't do that boom, but hey, what's up? That's done. No, boom. There you go, boy. As soon as it's, you go, don't take, you go and stay on it until it's done. And that's what I did. I jumped on the opportunity. Right? We are in that opportunity now.
Yeah.
And so as we walk into this thing, jump at the opportunity of this season. Jump at the opportunity. Don't let that pass. You got wide open shots. It's spiritually moist. That scripture where it talks about a wealthy place. In other words, there's a moist place. A prosperous place, a fruitful place. And that's where we are right now. We're in a place spiritually. Say that word, spiritually.
Spiritually,
we're in a place that if we take advantage of it, we will be able to get some good gains out of it. Glory to God. I always believe in getting all I can out of most stuff I do most of the time. You know, whenever you go to the store, you try to get as much as you can get. When you go and go through the food pantry, I like to just get a couple of things and be like, no, you try to get as much as you can and write right about it. Now I'm saying this for a reason. Because I want you all to be so purposeful about receiving that you begin to make sure that you don't get distracted. And then from praise and worship all the way through, because we're about to step into the Jewish feast. We're about to step into the spring feast. We're about to step into a time that people believe Jesus will come back during this season of the time of the feast. And so we're about to step into an anointed time. So I just want to encourage you all on the fast, keep on fasting. One more week, right? Some folks will fast no longer, but one more week fasting. And make sure you pray. Not just eat, not eat, but pray. Amen. Make sure, because it's saying that this is an anointed season. Now, do me a favor and just shake yourself. Now, shake yourself, all right? Now, I am an audience participation preacher, and y'all know that. And I'm gonna need y'all help, all right? I'm gonna need y'all help today. So help us, help me out as we celebrate Palm Sunday. This is a very anointed
interest in time. So let's see what we can do with this. Before we go with anything else, let me get to the word. Let's have the word to come on. All right. Let's see. Let's see what we can do. Go ahead and turn. To Mark, St. Mark, chapter 11. St. Mark, chapter 11. Happy Palm Sunday again to you. And can I get a good reader for me to read? Let's read this occasion we're in. Someone that can read powerfully, loud, and authoritative. Read verses 1 down to verse 10 for me, please.
And when they came nigh to Jerusalem.
When they came nigh to Jerusalem.
Unto Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives. Two of his disciples, and saith unto them, Go your way into the village over against you, and as soon as ye be entered into it, ye shall find a colt tied, whereon never man sat. Loose him, and bring him. And if any man say unto you, Why do ye this? Say ye that the Lord hath need of him, and straightway he will send him hither. And they went their way and found the colt tied by the door without in a place where two ways met. And they loosed him. And certain of them that stood there said unto them, What do ye, loosing the colt? And they said unto them, Even as Jesus had commanded. And they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and cast their garments on him. And he sat upon him. And many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches off the trees and strawed them in the way. And they that went before and they that followed cried, saying, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the kingdom of our father David that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Thank you, wife. We're reading this, and this is the Mark's account of the Jesus as he enters triumphantly into Jerusalem. All four Gospels talk about it, so that means very important. All four Gospels talk about it. And so here, we see here, and as we look at this, what's happening is so interesting because what's going on is not just him coming back to town, but literally this is a coordination, going on. So today, let's see if we can, for a little bit before we do the other formalities of church, let's see if we can preach from the subject, crown him king. Crown him king. Let's see that. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord, for this. Thank you, Lord, for this time that we can come to you and celebrate this Palm Sunday. Father, as I do, as we do, I pray that the atmosphere will lift. I pray I come against every distracting, everything that will try to distract people from the word, that will try to distract them in their minds. In the name of Jesus, I bind every attack that's come, that will try to come against the word, so that it will distract them and not to hear the word. So, Lord, I pray that both that this spirit man is attentive, alert, and ready to receive whatever you have for him, because we're entering into a miracle season. Glory to God. And we believe we receive ours in advance. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, so I want to talk from that subject, crown him king. But then we're going to finish off with the spirit victory. The spirit victory will finish off the devil. But crowning him king, you know, the scriptures talk about crowns. As a matter of fact, there's around five or six scriptures about crowns in the Word, where the Bible talks about a crown of life. When you are in James chapter 1, verse 12, listen to this. Blessed, James 1, 12, blessed is the man that endureth temptation. Isn't that blessed is the man, not that hit the new car? But Chanel, blessed is the man or woman that endureth temptation. Blessed is that person that endured temptation. And so don't run from temptation. Don't run from a problem. Just because a problem is coming your way, don't mean you're not blessed. Just because you're going through something, don't mean you're not blessed. Just because there's a trial, it doesn't mean you're not blessed. Somebody shout, I'm blessed. The blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive, watch this, y'all, the crown of life. Glory to God. So in the midst of while you're going through stuff, and in the midst of while you're going through being tried, at the end of the road, when you go to heaven, there's a crown of life that you will get. So the crown of life is for those that stand and endure. The crown of life is for those that endure temptation. The Bible says the race is not given to the swift or to the strong, but rather to them that endure to the end. Somebody shout amen. See, the thing is, you don't need to be stronger. You need to be some more endurance. You need to be a little more wind. Some of us need our second wind. You ever run before and you ever run cross country a long mile, a couple miles? I didn't run cross country, but I would run the mile running. You run that thing, and you be all tired. Yeah. Woo! Mm. You trying to breathe the proper way, but you like, and you be going by your way. But then all of a sudden, you be all tired. But if I ever run and you tired, but all of a sudden, a second wind kick in, and something kick in, and you like, oh, okay, woo, man. See, that's what God is going to do as we approach Easter, as we approach this resurrection, as we step through the gateway of this triumphant entry, as we step in on this Palm Sunday, as we pray to look and see what God is doing. We are stepping into miraculous victory because God is about to give you a second wind. Woo! Man, I tell you what, I need myself, I need that second wind. Lord, thank you for the second wind. Thank you for reviving and rejuvenating. Yeah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Sometimes you need a little pump, a little spark, a little boost. Glory to God. You just push it, but he needs to push it. And God can give you that second wind. He's going to give you that push you need. Somebody say amen. The crown of life is for them that endure. That they endure. It says, which the Lord promised them that love him, crown of life. So that's the promise. We love him, we endure him. He said, I'm going to give you a crown of life. Then there's what they call the crown of righteousness. The crown of righteousness in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8. Henceforth, there is laid for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. If you love his appearing, that means you're looking for his appearing. See, the crown of righteousness are given to those that love his appearing, that love his appearing, and that are looking for his appearance. But at the same time, the crown of righteousness is not about you. It's not about what you be. It's not just about what you do, but the crown of righteousness is about what Jesus did. And we can get the crown of righteousness not because of us, but because of him. Because at the end of the day, when it all comes down, we're going to take everything we have anyway, and we're going to place it right to him anyway. And it's me, glory to God. All that he's given me, we're just going to give right back. I'm going to keep that crown with those jewels tonight. No, you in heaven, you're ready, you're good. You don't have to try to hop the crown. You can go ahead and give it. Come on, somebody. The pawn shop in heaven. And 1 Corinthians 9:25, and every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate or disciplined. Every talks about athletes and those that going for the gold. Every Olympic athlete, the Bible says he is temperate in all things, disciplined in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we are being disciplined. We are disciplining ourselves, and we are making sure we do that and walk in self-control, because we're looking for the incorruptible crown. So the incorruptible crown will go to those that have been disciplined and that walk in self-control. God will say, I know you wanted to get out of line. I know you didn't feel like getting yourself together, but you know what? You want the discipline. You want the self-control. Here's the crown. Here's the incorruptible crown. Glory to God. That won't be corrupted by this world. Then there's a crown of rejoicing. Some say it's the soul-winning crown. I wonder how many of us would get that crown. How many of us get that crown of rejoicing? A soul-winning crown. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Verse 19, for what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ? Now, the crown of rejoicing, the Bible says we're supposed to rejoice always. The Bible says, and again I say what? So he says we're going to rejoice always. He didn't say rejoice only when it's good. Nah, right? We got to rejoice always. So a crown of rejoicing. Now check this out. Now the Bible does say rejoice always, but Christians, we're supposed to have more joy than first of all anybody else on this earth. Amen? And so Luke tells us that there is a rejoicing also in heaven, that there's a rejoicing that goes on in heaven. I mean, every time something good happens, every time somebody gets saved, there's a party, there's rejoicing in heaven. Heaven is a place of rejoicing. Heaven is a place that you rejoice, because every time a soul gets saved, every time somebody says yes to Jesus, there's a party going on up there. Glory to God. It's a rejoicing place. If you don't like loudness, if you don't like sunshine, if you don't like brightness, if you don't like rejoicing, if you don't like seeing people happy, if you don't like seeing people smile, if you don't like to be energetic, that heaven is not going to be done. It's going to be all the people, all the things. Everybody will be excited. It's going to be, man. Just think about it. Do you ever think about heaven sometimes? I know we got bills, and I know we got to deal with life, but heaven, do you think about heaven? Because one day you will die, dead as a doorknob. Where are you going to go? I'm young. People die younger and younger. The older are living longer. Woo! Heaven. Then there's also, well, the crown of rejoicing. The crown of rejoicing will be a reward. Where the Bible says Revelations 21:14, where God will wipe away every tear, and there should be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying, and there should be no more pain. Somebody should be happy on that one. No more pain. As a matter of fact, if I can have days of heaven on earth, then in the name of Jesus, Lord, we command all pain to go. Why we got to go to heaven? In the name of Jesus, we believe no crime. We believe you will wipe my way out even now. We believe you will do it even some stuff even now. No pain. And all the foreign things are passed away. So the crown that crown of rejoicing, we won't be nothing to cry about or whine about or be depressed about or be sad about. But what about other family members if they didn't, like somebody, your friend, they not available or something? Well, you're not thinking about that. Yeah. In heaven, you don't get bad news. You get good news. There's no bad in heaven. When, like prison, if your mom or dad, they're not looking at God, not
when we go to heaven, there'll be no more crying. Man, no more hustle and bustle. Anyway, I walk there. But then there's also a crown, blessing, a crown of glory. In 1 Peter 5 and 4, the Bible says, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, Jesus, he's the head of all pastors, ye shall receive a crown of glory that they did not give. That's the crown of glory. That's the shepherd's crown. That's what I need. I'm working on. So the crown, and there's different crowns, and when we go to heaven, we know what the Bible says, we're going to be rewarded by the deeds we've done. We don't have to give account for the deeds we've done in our body. But I thank God, because when we go to heaven, I thank God because there is a reward waiting for us in the name of Jesus. And so I give God praise and give God glory because these crowns are waiting on you. Glory to God. So shall crown him king on this Palm Sunday. It's so interesting because before I get into the story of it, let me give you one other need, another list. And then it says, Palms are powerful. I'm going to read some stuff to you so I can hurry up and get to the story. First of all, a palm tree is a symbol of victory. A palm tree is a symbol of victory, of triumph, of peace, and eternal life. As a matter of fact, in Psalms 92 and 12, it says, the righteous, say that's me, shall flourish like a palm tree. So now God says, you're going to flourish like a palm tree and grow like the cedars in Lebanon. So remember, when I said Palm Sunday was, you're entering into this holy season.
Yeah.
You're entering into holy week. You're entering into something holy. You're entering into a time when God comes and tells you it's time to give. The time, the feast time that he tells you. Well, a couple of times during the spring feast, it's time to tell you to give. Because it's an open heaven during that time. It's a portal open. There's something going on during this time. It's every year.
Come on, teacher, Pastor.
But then the thing about it, God says, I open it. It's like you open heaven. You live by that open heaven based on not what God does, but what you do. So if you don't tithe, that's not what God is up to you. So when it comes to giving, you don't give us up to you, not God. So God says, I give you hope in heaven, but you can take it grass. So there's a portal, there's something we're entering into. Now the thing is, you, what are you going to do with the opportunity? What are you going to dive into this opportunity and jump in it, or are you going to come through it? But in this season, in this time, we're going to be like that palm tree, and we're going to flourish. Because some of us have been dealing with setbacks and been dealing with resistance. But God says, as we step in this this Palm Sunday season, and as we step into this holy season, God says, woo, glory to God. Y'all ready? God says, get ready for that thing to flourish. And that's a big thing. Hallelujah. I believe in the flourish. Put that on your lips, on your mind. Thank you, Lord, my business is flourishing. My business is flourishing. Thank you, Lord, my health is flourishing. Thank you, Lord, my money's flourishing. Somebody shout, I'm flourishing. I look at your neighbor and say, I'm flourishing. I'm flourishing. Now, a palm tree, they use it because of, they use that because of the symbolism. It's a symbol of victory. And they, one of the things that they say that is so interesting about it is the uprightness of the palm tree. That the palm tree, just real quick, is taller than the others. It's tall. It is y'all see palm tree. But they say, you know, when you look at the other trees, they, you know, no matter how they are, the palm trees are, as they would say, angels, are above, are standing tall above. And see, you look at the forest and look around all the trees. Or if it was a bunch of forests, or if it was a bunch of trees, and there was a palm tree in the midst of it, if you just look, you're going to see it protruding up. You're going to see those palms that are right about it.
Yeah.
Now you've been going through the hustle and bustle of your job, of your life, of your business, of all this different stuff, and you've been trying to get ahead, and you've been trying to stand out and everything, but God is about to cause the light to shine on you, and He's about to cause you to be seen head and shoulders above others. But I'm sure He's about to make you tall in the spirit. They will see you for some reason and not see somebody else. Somebody shout, there's a promotion coming for you. God wants to cause you to grow and cause you to be head and shoulders higher. He wants you to excel in the path. Glory to God. It's flourishing season. Glory to God. It's flourishing season. Hallelujah. It's house selling season. Receive it. Glory to God. Another thing about it, they say that a palm tree is fruitful. They say it's because of its symbolic fruitfulness. It's fruitful. What God wants to do and flourish like a palm tree is in this, as we step into this Palm Sunday and step into this Holy Week, He wants us to bear fruit. You remember, He wants us to be fruitful.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Bearing fruit. One of the things people love about a palm tree is pretty beauty. It's beautiful. And the Bible says He will beautify the meek with salvation. Glory to God. It's pretty. And God wants to beautify your life. He wants to beautify you. Not only do you think about a palm tree, not only do you think about how beautiful they be, but when you see them, they look refreshing. It just looks like, woo, fun in the sun. It's just something about the thing. It's not only beautiful, but it just symbolizes refreshing. It symbolizes rest. And that's what God wants to do, refresh you and get you some rest. Hallelujah. No matter what's going on, I got this going on, I got that going on. But do you know God knows how to cause you to rest in the midst of the hustle and bustle? Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's beautiful. God wants to beautify himself. Glory to God. He wants to beautify the meek. With salvation, with deliverance. That word salvation don't mean being saved. That word salvation is a package. The word salvation means to heal, means to deliver, means to be saved, means to prosper. It means to be made whole. So God wants your whole man to be touched. Hallelujah. He beautifies the meek with salvation. Hallelujah. Your deliverance is here. Another thing it says is they talk about this elasticity. Uh-huh. The one thing about it, that thing is bent, but it won't break. See, and the enemy makes you look at you, and you may look at you, and you may be bending, and you may be bending yourself, woo, boy. But look at your neighbor and say, I will not break. Look at your neighbor and say, I may be bending, and this may be trying to cause me to get me aggravated. It's trying to push me over here. It's trying to push me over there. But I will not break. No, see, the enemy trying to break you. The enemy is trying to break you. He's trying to get you out. He's trying to get you disappointed to the point where you say, you know what? Just forget it. I just work 14 jobs and get ahead. But God's like, no. The enemy wants you to say, forget it. I'll just do whatever. But no, the devil is alive. Hallelujah. But I will not break. I will not break. Somebody shout, I will not break. I don't know who's here for. The enemy trying to break you. The enemy will try to break it down. Trying to make you just give up. But how many of y'all know that the devil is a liar? If he's telling you to give up, you better keep pressing on it. Paul said, I press toward the mark. I press. I forget another thing for something. Look at your neighbor and say, it's time. look at your neighbor in your preacher's voice and say, it's time to preach.
So next Sunday, I already got the message for next week.
this Sunday. I just want to preach. I don't want to teach nothing. I just want to preach something. I want to preach to my boys leave. I want to preach until the trees come in. I want to preach until the raccoons get to go look at it. We need a good preaching. Y'all been taught up enough. But look at the Lord, say, y'all too bad as man anyway. Y'all got to use some spiritual weight.
Before the festivities. But the funny part about it is
walked in. Because he was doing that, but when he walked in there, when he rolled in there, the Bible says that when he walked, he rolled in there. The Bible says that that when they did, they cast the garments on him. And then he set up. And then when he began to walk in there, in Jerusalem, the Bible says they started spreading their garments. They started putting those palm trees down. And they started doing that. And they started saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. They started worshiping. They started giving him praise. They started giving him his coronation. They started doing what they did whenever they would put a key on the throne. See, when you look up in 2 Kings 9 and 3, you look up 2 Kings 9 and 13, and you look at 1 Kings chapter 1, verse 32 through 48, you will see Solomon tells him to put David on his own mule and parade him through the street and parade him and take him to the palace so he can walk before the people and they can cast their garments. So he got on the donkey and he did that, and then he did the exact same thing. 2 Kings 9:13, Jehu. They got him, put him on the donkey, and did the exact same thing, and made him king. So when Jesus was going in there, on the donkey, and they were worshiping him, they literally was crowning him king. They were crowning him as king, that he is the king. They were looking to him saying, you want to come? Because remember, they wanted to be rescued. They wanted to be politically rescued. They wanted to be saved because Rome was over them. Caesar was over them. They wanted somebody to come and deliver them. So they're worshiping him. And they all wrong anyway in the midst of it all. They thank God they worshiping him, but the next thing they killed him. But they, because they were looking for an earthly reign. They wanted him to come as king and set up as a king on the earth and run things on the earth from Jerusalem right there. They wanted him to set up an earthly thing. They were looking at it in the flesh. Letting them know, and Jesus lets them know, my kingdom is not of this world. He came to establish a spiritual kingdom. Yeah. And he came, and as he went forth and went in there and began to go forth in that crown, as they begin to worship him, and as they begin to give him glory, as they begin to give him honor. They begin to talk out. You know, remember, Jesus always told them, don't tell nobody nothing about it. When you read it, he tells them, he tells them, he told them, y'all say nothing, the kid is the cross of Christ. He said, the kid is the Christ. He said, because, no, remember, when it's time to pray, Jesus believed in you giving him praise. Because remember, when he came in, he wasn't being, don't be loud. No, he was sitting there worshiping. I'm taking my proper place as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Maybe not like you think I am, but I'm taking my rightful place. And see, when you begin to crown him as king, you let him take his rightful place in your life. That he's just not a savior that you go visit on Sunday, but he is your king that you get permission for, and you get your direction from every day. He's your king on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday, on Thursday, on Friday. God. I'm trying to tell you about this stuff here, but see, this is a time of victory. Somebody shout victory. See, victory, let's not just have victory that you struggle for. Let's have victory that you can't help but to walk in. What do you mean? Well, it's one thing when you just have, it's one thing when you just have a prayer life when you just pray. But it's another thing when the spirit prayer is effortless. Yeah. It's one thing when prophecy, but it's one thing when the spirit prophecy.
Yeah.
It's one thing when you get wisdom,
The spirit of wisdom, the spirit of everything, the spirit of God, when he comes, when he makes it easy. He makes things easier. Amen? He makes things, easier. And when you look at, and see, when you look at this thing, we just don't want to have victory, but we want to have the spirit of victory. See, the spirit of victory, woo, is on the inside. The spirit of victory has nothing to do with what's going on out there. The spirit of victory has no, and don't care about none of this. The Bible says, we believe in our, and therefore we speak. The Bible lets us know the way our faith works. We have the same spirit of faith. We believe, therefore we speak. See, I believe I have the victory, therefore I praise him for the victory. The spirit of faith, the spirit of victory is just like the spirit of faith. It starts from the inside and works its way out. The spirit of faith is, I believe it, therefore I. So therefore, the spirit of victory is, I believe I have the victory, therefore I express it. Woo! Win all the time. God, from me to them, give us all the spirit of victory. That when we want to give up, you can't give up. That when we want to throw in the towel, that it's just like Jeremiah. That when we said we wouldn't say nothing, it's just like fire set up in my bone. Ooh, somebody shout, I have the victory. So as we look at this whole thing with the crowning him king, as they crown him king, and we look at the whole coronation of Palm Sunday, we see the significance of it. The significance of it is not just only for religious and traditional times, but it's a real spiritual thing that was happening during that time. That he was coming forth as a pioneer and coming forth, getting ready to make the ultimate sacrifice. He was born coming in there and into Jerusalem, getting ready to do the unthinkable. He was born in Jerusalem to do something that was going to revolutionize the earth, that was going to revolutionize the world, that was going to revolutionize my life and yours. He was about to do something that was going to change history forever. But he had to get and step through that door and walk through that door in Jerusalem and begin to start this week out. And as he did, it opened up that anointing, it opened up something so great that because of this season that we celebrate, we look at how he saved us, we look at how he delivered us, we look at how he filled us with the Holy Ghost, we look at how he healed our bodies, we look at the redemption work of Christ that we are celebrating. And when you look at all that he's done, and when you look at all that he's done for you, and look at all he's done for others, I'm telling you, stir yourself up, because what he's done this year for you so far pales in comparison to what you are about to step into. You haven't seen nothing yet. You haven't seen the blessing of this year yet. But as we step through this day, as we step through this past, our Passover season, as we step through the door of this time of the Palm Sunday, God is going to call you to stop, to jump, to spirit of victory, that you may thanks be unto God that always causes us to triumph. He's going to do something on the inside of us. He's doing it right now. He's doing something on the inside. He's removing the anger. He's removing the frustration. He's removing the sadness. He's removing all that other stuff that you've been fighting and you've been casting out and you've been walking through. God says, I'm about to call and bring deliverance. I'm about to call. I'm going to root some stuff. I'm going to root things out.
God said, I'm touching people's bodies right now. And you start listening or looking or feeling. You may feel something change in your body. Whatever you need from God, God says it's here right now. You can receive it right now. You can take it right now. The spirit of victory is here. The victory is yours. The victory is yours. If you believe it, I dare to give God a victorious break.
That they would answer the call.
that you was giving them the dreams. That's what people will get. God said he's going to give you some dreams. He's going to begin to give y'all dreams. He's going to give some of you dreams. Dream of God. Some of you are going to dream in the middle of the day while you're taking a nap and dream. God will clarify things and let you know stuff in dreams. Hallelujah. He's going to dream to dreams and visions. Dreams and visions. I'm a supernatural God. He says, and I'm going to speak to you supernaturally. I'm going to speak to you in your spirit. So you got to be spiritually minded during the season. Make sure you're spiritually minded so you don't miss what I want to say. So you don't miss what I want to do. So you don't miss my leading. Be spiritual minded because I want to lead you and guide you. Hallelujah. You all that said, I haven't heard God in a while. You all that said, it seems like God ain't talking that much. You all, some of you said, I haven't heard him like I used to. And then, glory to God. And the Lord says, you're about to get even clearer than you used to. He says, you've been faithful and you've been standing in the midst of a lot of time when it seemed like you may have been quiet. And the Lord says, he wants, not only will you hear him, but you want to hear him better than you've ever heard him before in your life. Glory to God. So, Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this time. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for the victory. We thank you for the spirit of victory. We receive it. Now lift your hands and believe. Baptize me with the spirit of victory. Baptize with the spirit of victory. Indulge, Lord. I bind discouragement, oppression, depression, and everything that comes along with that. We bind it. And we bind all its attributes. We bind the strong man of oppression and depression. And we bind all every attribute and characteristic in the name of Jesus. I pray, God, that even though yes, Lord, deliverance in this fast. Deliverance in this fast. You are delivered. The Lord told me to tell some of y'all, so whoever it is, you are delivered. You are delivered. You just have to have the courage to step out of the house. I heard it clear as I can tell you. He said, you are delivered. It's just the courage. It's just the courage to step out of it. You're fearful. You're letting fear keep you in that cage. But God said, the glory is on you. Step out of it. Step out of it into your freedom. Step out of it. Step out of it. Don't be afraid. Don't be fearful. Step out of it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. For all that you see, for all that you do. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And God says, I don't know who this for. God says, he hasn't forgotten about you. He hasn't forgotten about you. You're not on your own. You're not by yourself. You're not lonely. He says, for some of you all, it may seem like that because he got you on a place that he wants to talk to you. He got you on a place that he wants to deal with you. He got you on a place that he wants to work on you. So God says, I didn't abandon you.
Glory and power forever.
Y'all take a picture of this already? Anybody take a picture of this?
Somebody take a picture so we can put, you know, you gotta take a picture. No, you know, you gotta take pictures all the time. Pictures everything. But I just want to see if somebody took a picture. It's very beautiful. But it's nice, amen. I want to give a big hug. God bless you. See what we don't have for the Easter Sunday. So thank God for that. Thank God for everyone. Thank God for you. I think that's it. So Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for this offering. Thank you for everyone that's sown their seed. Father, I declare increase this week. Lord, you want to give a great thing in our finances this week. You want to make an ocean and a portion of that. I make you full of God. Lindsay's supposed to get some money up there. Hallelujah. Some of y'all get some stuff by Wednesday. Some people get it before Wednesday. So I see money coming in the mail in the name of Jesus. I'm telling you, I see some surprise. These two words are here, gifts and surprises. And God said, you're about to find some more money, Satan. Lost money, man. I don't know why, but God said, you're going to find some money. You got to, I don't know. Give him a lookout. He found some money. Jimmy, can't you see? God says, as long as you yield your heart to me, as long as you can stay with me and walk upright before me, I'll keep promoting.
Glory to God.
I'll keep promoting. Bless the Lord. And you will be a supervisor. All because of your faithfulness to me, said Lord.
Hallelujah.
I will promote you out there. And you're faithful to me spiritually. I want to promote you out there.
Glory to God.
So when people start getting on your nerves and some other stuff start trying to come, and other people try to do stuff, distract you, don't get distracted. Because I can see God's power promote you. I just see you keep getting promoted and everything. You're like, what? And it's not because you're perfect, it's just because you said, I'm being for what I'm going to be. And so yeah, thank you. Praise God. Glory to God.
Amen.
Glory to God. And see, the devil said, y'all wasn't a maker up to this point. The devil said, y'all wasn't even supposed to. The devil's mad because y'all was supposed to have been cut up or bitter. Amen. And he, you know what I'm saying? And now he's trying to throw stuff up there. He's trying to cause stupid. I don't know. He's trying to cause stupid stuff and everything to come up and everything. That's because of the brick you come from. The house is just what the house is. But there's something brick that happens. There's something about to happen. You plan really hard for something about one of your girls. You really plan. It's not impossible, and if you believe, all things are possible. Glory to God. Don't feel inferior. Just because you may not pray the same way as your wife or some other folks pray. That's the kind of prayer. He says, your prayer is fine. Just talk to me. That's all I need. Just talk to me. Even when you're frustrated, say, God, man. I get it. God, man. Man, I'm trying, Lord. I see that, and of course, just keep on talking. And the more you talk, the more you talk, the more you hurt yourself. And it'll start developing more and more and more. But don't listen to somebody else. Just stay strong. Because y'all agree that it's important for that prayer. I don't know what it is, but it's an impossible situation.
whatever it is, it's something that is something naturally possible. And that's why the enemy wants y'all to stay out of agreement, because agreement is what you need for that miracle. How? And everything. So no, the enemy's trying to keep y'all apart. Now he's trying to mess with y'all, I'm trying to mess with kids. But somebody said the devil's a liar. Because his plans have worked so far and they will not work. So I know I think, scooch a little bit. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Somebody shout, glory.
Glory.
But there's more.
Glory to God.
Not in the work field, but even as you pray, and if you pray and see my face and go and come before me and ask me, even in this time, even in this week, said Lord, I will tell you some things and surprise you, and I will let you know about things that I want you to do that you may not want to hear about right now. But there's some things that I want you to do, that I've called you to do in life, that will cause those other desires you have for other things to manifest more. Because it's not the job and the money that's going to open the doors for that, but it's because of your obedience, it will open doors, it will open up those other doors. I see things opening up for you through just obedience. So the Lord says, just be obedient and step out into the unfamiliar. Step out into what you're not used to. Step out. Ever since the prophetess word came, the enemy really would try to get you to move back and really try to get you to kind of stay still with that thing. But God says there is visions and dreams that's being imparted. That gift of gifting is being imparted with visions and dreams to you from your mother. And God says, the same way I have spoken and I begin to speak to your mother in dreams and in visions, and the way I did with her when she first started going to Bread of Heaven and seeing things in the spirit and seeing stuff in the spirit, God says, I'm about to revolutionize your life in the spirit like I did with her. I'm about to cause an impartation to fall down upon you, saith the Lord. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Get back at the right time, Molly, because I don't know what's about to happen. Something about to change for the good. Something about to change for the glory to God. Something about to change for the good. And there's about to be rejoicing and provision. I don't know why, when I looked at you, I just saw a fruit basket and everything. And I just saw a fruit basket. Bountifulness. And God, glory to God, is causing, going to cause you to flourish. Glory to God. He's going to cause you to flourish. But what he's going to do more than anything, is he's getting down on the inside, and he's doing something in your spirit, man. He's doing something in your spirit. He's doing something in your heart. He's changing some stuff in your heart. He's changing things. He's doing the inside work first. There's an inside work that he's doing, and some things that he's working on. And the more you comply, and the more you become, this is word, pliable, like putty. He wants your heart and your will to be like clay up, so he can just mold it. To mold it and make it how he wants to make it. You a strong-willed individual. And the Lord says, just yield to me. Yield to me. Yield to me. Watch this. Watch what I do. And your son, I got him. Your son, I got his back. Your son, I'm watching out for him. Your son, no weapon formed against him shall prosper. I am looking out for him. And he will do what I have called him to do, saith the Lord. I bind witchcraft, and I bind every evil word. I bind Delilah. I bind that spirit of Delilah that will try to come against him in the name of Jesus. I bind that seducing spirit that will try to come. I come against that. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
So I just talk like this. Okay? Just dig. Keep on digging. Just keep on digging. Just keep on digging. Then he said, that's you in the season to where you dig. Start digging. Like, look for buried treasure. Because I will show you treasure that's going to come through my word. And I'm going to give you ideas, and I'm going to show you things about your own body and your own life personally, and give you the revelation about stuff you don't talk to me about, that you don't talk to me about. He says, instead of talking about that you be thinking about and concerned about God, he will give you wisdom about those things. And he's wisdom about stuff concerning your body in the name of Jesus. And he's going to give you the wisdom of God about it, and those, and the doctor, you have to tell the doctors about it and change some other stuff. Because no weapon going to get you. And as you did, he's going to give you revelation. And revelation. So watch out for distraction. Keep digging. Keep digging. Keep praying. Keep praying. Your household needs you. Your family needs you. Your family needs you. Your prayers are working. Your prayers are working. Your prayers are working. I don't care how much they do this, or they do this, or they do that. Your prayers are working. They are hot. You hear me? They are hot. And they are hot. They fight with this. I'm telling you, it's working. It's working. It's working. Somebody say it's working, but it's working.
Victory!
Victory!
Blessings.